Hey there, Josh Powers again with Quixel, and welcome to the next video in this series on Mixer's Mass Stack. Today we're going to talk about the normal component, so let's dive right in. At its core, the normal mass component acts very similarly to the position gradient. However, it does factor in the mix's normal information to determine how the mask will be revealed. So if we add a normal mask to this layer above the rocky surface, and then go into mask mode, we can see how the mask adjusts to the normal data of the surface based on the angle of rotation. The settings inside the normal component are nearly identical to the position gradient, so I'll just briefly go over them again, and then we'll get to some practical examples of how to utilize the normal mask component. We have the angle handle here, which lets us determine the angle the mask is coming from. Notice how all the faces and normals pointed away from the projected mask angle are black, while the normals facing the angle are white. This is what makes this component so incredibly useful. We can also change the tilt of the projection, which will give it more of a top-down appearance. Or, if you click the below radio button, the tilt will come from below. Then we have a drop-down menu for how Mixer will source the mask. Just like position gradient, mesh and underlying mix is default, and this uses the base mesh and textures, as well as all the layers beneath. So if I toggle the surface layer on, you can see how the normal data beneath is being factored into the results of the mask. Next, we'll select Mesh and Base Normal Map, and this acts like position gradient's mesh and base displacement, except it's relying on the normal information rather than displacement. This setting will use the mesh and associated normal data for the mask, and ignore all the other layers beneath it. Mesh only, as it sounds, will only utilize the geometry normals of the mesh itself and not factor in any of the texture-generated normals in the mix. And then lastly, we'll bounce back up to mesh and current layer, which looks identical to the mesh only. And that's because the solid layer I'm currently using does not have any texture normals associated with it, so it's relying exclusively on the mesh. However, if I turn on this layer above that's using a Megascan surface, you'll see that it's utilizing the normal data of the surface itself along with the mesh. These four options offer us a lot of control on how this component will generate the mask, and you can get some really nice results depending on how you use them. And then we have the range sliders, which basically gives us the transition between the white and black pixels. The further apart the sliders, the broader the transition gets, and the closer the sliders, the sharper the transition, giving it a strong contrast. One thing to note is that the lower range slider by default is set to 0.5 for the normal component, unlike position gradient, which defaults the same slider at 0. And then lastly, of course, is invert, so you can invert your results. All right, now that we're finished with that, let's move on to some practical examples. Here we've got a small rock formation, but say we need to add a bit of moss to the top to fit the environment it'll be used in. Well, that's very easy to do using just a few mask components, specifically the normal component. So let's go ahead and activate this mossy ground surface layer that I grabbed from the Megascans library, and this surface for the most part uses the standard settings. However, I did lower the wrapped underlying down quite a bit so that the rock normals didn't come through so pronounced. I wanted the height and normal data to be extracted from the moss itself instead of the rock, which really helps sell the thickness and depth of the vegetation. I also scaled down the size of the moss texture to fit the scale of the rock a little bit better, and then lastly I disabled the displacement layer so that the edges of the mask won't have sharp, unnatural height to them. And that's it for the texture settings, so let's give this layer a mask stack, and then the first thing I'm going to do is add a map component. As I mentioned in the position gradient tutorial, we'll be releasing a video dedicated to the map component very soon, so I won't go into much detail now. But in this instance, I am going to source my map from the mossy ground layer and then adjust the range to give some nice and tight edges. Now it does look a little strange at the moment, so let's add a normal component next. We'll set the tilt to 0 degrees so it comes from above, and then push the range settings pretty close together on the high end to really get some good hits on the upward facing normals. And now if we set the blend mode to add, we can combine the revealed areas of this mask with the mask from the component below, which is getting us much closer to the results we're looking for. If I hit 9 on the keyboard, I can go into mask mode and see how the combined masks are looking. However, if I hit 0 on the keyboard, I can also view just the active layer I'm working on, which shows me what this normal component's doing by itself. This is a really helpful way to focus on one mask layer at a time. Okay, this is looking pretty cool, but we're not quite done yet. So let's add a Gaussian blur modifier and give it a really low strength to soften some of those sharper, more pixelated portions of the mask. Lastly, I want to restrict the moss to the very top of the formation. So to quickly get rid of the moss below that point, we'll add a position gradient. Set it to multiply. Then simply adjust the range so that the darker pixels of the layer will mask out the moss below a certain point. If we go to the active mask mode, we can see how the position gradient looks here. Because this position gradient is at the top of the stack, the white area will reveal the mask we've built, and the black area will hide it. And just like that, we've given this rock formation some nice moss coverage. Here's another example of how we can use the normal component to add a depth of realism for our textures. Say we want to add some dirt and dust building up on this chest. Well, we can quickly achieve that with a curvature component and two normal components. We'll start off by enabling the dirt layer, which uses all the standard settings except for the scale, which I lowered quite a bit, and then we'll add a curvature component. I'll switch to mask mode, and then I'll set the drop down to cavities only, and then drag the right slider way down. This gives us some great masking that's bunched up near intersecting edges and cavities along the wood grain. If I go back to render mode and toggle the layer, we have some pretty cool results here, but the problem is that the curvature doesn't take direction into account. And while grime and dirt does build up on vertical surfaces in real life, we're going for more of a dusty or loose dirt look here, and we know that gravity will prevent that from building up too much on vertical faces. So we'll want this layer to be limited to surfaces that face upward. That's where the normal component comes into play. Going back to mask mode, I'll add a normal layer, and then all I'm going to do is set the tilt to be from above, and then set the layer to multiply. Again, by setting this to multiply, all of the curvature mask on the non-upward facing normals are removed, leaving just the upward facing portions of the mask to be revealed. This gives us a nice dusty looking chest. We can take this even further by adding another normal component on top, set it to come from above. Then we'll simply lower the opacity so that not only do we have the stronger, thicker details of the dust and dirt, but also a very faint layer covering all of the up-facing normals. This kind of subtle effect can go a long way to creating believable textures. And if you want to go even further, you can add a paint mask layer on top of this and remove some of the dust by hand. And that'll do it for the normal mask component. I hope this video was helpful for you to learn more about Mixer's Mask Stack, and stay tuned for the next video coming tomorrow. Thanks so much for watching, and we'll see you in the next one.